rocket waters. And someday I'll go back again. I'll walk the way and I'll wander in. And this time I don't think I'm gonna leave. River runs outside my door.
And isn't this a beautiful day to be here to celebrate life and everything? And we want to thank you, Audra, for your amazing music. And we have a slight changing over the service this morning. I think you noticed, if you came here early, there was a countdown at 3 minutes. And Audra and I and our staff were talking about, we really want to celebrate the music and have people begin the service in a little bit more prayerful way. And also at the same time, people come here to celebrate and to see each other and to meet new people and so on. And so we wanted to find a balance between that and finding a way to begin the service. And so what you saw is what we're going to be doing now. And so we're very thankful. As we pay attention and as the singing bowl gets our attention and brings us here and now, and a sense of wonder and connection and oneness. It's what it's all about. So one of the things I like to do is welcome everybody. We're glad you're here. And we have a teaching that is really important. The Unity offers you a direct and intense experience of the sacred personally and in a loving spiritual community. So it's one of the beliefs and takeaways that people get from Unity and their time in Unity, that we have a direct and intense experience of the sacred quite often our Sunday service is full of different experiences of sacred, all the way from with our children and all the way from when you greet each other, and all the, and meditation and music and a message. It's all a pathway to the heart. And so that's part of what we believe. And we invite you to join us at any time, and we're glad that you're here with us this morning. So let's continue the heart opening with some more music.
Good morning, everyone. Rise if you'd like to and sing with us.
We are gathering in song, welcoming the oneness, opening up the doors of spirit wide. We are walking into light, starting out together on a journey through the miracles inside. There is abundance in our fellowship. This is a place we belong. We trust our place in this great holiness. Now is the moment, sing along. We are gathering in song, welcoming the oneness, opening the doors of spirit wide. We are walking into light, starting out together on a journey through the miracles inside. Turn to your neighbor and say good morning. Welcoming the oneness, opening the doors of spirit wide. We are walking into light, starting out together on a journey through the miracles inside. We are walking into light, welcoming the oneness, opening the doors of spirit wide. We are walking into light, starting out together on a journey through the miracles inside. We are gathering in song, welcoming the oneness, opening the doors of spirit wide. We are walking into light, starting out together on a journey through the miracles inside. On a journey through miracles inside.
And now it's time for our children's moment. So come on up, children and children's ministry folks.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to mirror what Reverend Steve said. It's a beautiful spring morning, isn't it? What do you think of when you think of spring? Piano. I have some props. What do you think of? Flowers. What do you think of when you think of spring? Butterflies. Yay. Pardon? Mary Kinney gave me this, and she said I had to wear it. Should Mary wear it? No. Well, I'm going to give it to you so you can take it. So, yeah, springtime. I love spring. You see all the plants growing, the flowers. What I'm going to talk about today are monarch butterflies, butterflies in general, and pollinators. Does anybody know what a pollinator is? Yeah. What little things carry flower pollen? Bees, butterflies. You can't remember. You said bees. You know, you'd be surprised. How about, do you think bats carry pollen? Well, they do. Hummingbirds. Birds, mammals, bugs, they're all important. I'm going to show you something real quick because I am going to talk about monarchs and the miracle of monarch butterflies. Have you ever seen caterpillars before? What are caterpillars? Yeah. They're butterflies. Do they look like butterflies? They call that metamorphosis when they change from a caterpillar to a butterfly. Yeah. Ladybugs are good pollinators. Yeah. So this is a miracle in itself, just to talk about it. So I could talk all day long, but what I want to do is, and people accuse me of that, but what I want to do is talk about the importance of pollinators and flowers and everything and how important it is. So I brought a few other things I want to say is, my main thing is, if you remember, I always talk about the outdoors and how important the outdoors is. Get out and play, explore. You know, yesterday I took a walk, and I saw some butterflies, so I was happy. So one thing I'd like to do, and what I'm leaving with all of you, as well as the whole community, I've got thousands of packets of pollinator seeds to grow different prairie plants. I'm going to make those available. And promise me one thing, will you just kind of think about planting the seeds? And maybe you'll get flowers to grow and attract butterflies and attract other things. So, but butterflies are important. I've got to read this because I know I wouldn't say it right. When we talked about caterpillars, it said, just when the caterpillar thought, I'm incapable of flying, it became a butterfly. So this is all part of nature and seeing. And what I want to instill on you is to say, be like a butterfly, spread your wings, go outside, look at flowers. It's all part of a meditative process I think you can do. Will you promise me that? And you'll have seeds and different things that I have today for you to take home, as well as outside there are some pamphlets and seeds for everyone. And just contact me because I was told I can get thousands of packets. So don't feel like you're taking too many. And come up to me and say, hey, I'd like 30 packets. So please do that. So our thing today I'd like you to say is, soar high like a butterfly. Can you say that? Soar high like a butterfly. Let's bless the children.
Love you. We bless you. We appreciate you.
And we behold the Christ you are. Does anybody want to take these butterfly wings? And okay, here we go. You got to put them on. Can somebody, Mary, can you help him? So everybody kind of, I know it sounds silly, but maybe you can flap your wings and soar high as you leave. Have a good day.
All right, thank you. We want to welcome everyone here this morning. We're so glad you're here with us and you got a chance to listen to the butterfly and think about soaring like a butterfly yourself. My name is Bonnie and I'm your facilitator today. We're grateful for everybody who contributes to our service. We particularly would like to welcome our newcomers. If you're here for the first time, we welcome you. We thank you for being here. And if you'd like, you could raise your hand and our ushers will give you a welcome packet and you could to give you more information about Unity and some of the things you can get involved in here. Please feel free to sign up for our weekly e-news in the foyer as you leave. At Unity, we offer practical, positive spiritual teaching that empower abundant and meaningful living. We believe and practice five basic principles. Principle one is God is absolute good, everywhere present. Also, this is shared as there is only one presence and one power active in the universe and in my life, God the good. Please join me in affirming our vision, mission, and core values. Our vision is we celebrate a spiritually awakened world. And our mission is we inspire the awakening and practice of divine love in every heart. In addition, we celebrate our core values, knowing that we have come here to be spirit-centered and to express the values of love, peace, and connection. We are in a transition process right now here at Unity, and we have an affirmation we speak every Sunday. So let's affirm this together. As spirit-centered individuals and congregation, we have created a consciousness of love, trust, and openness. We affirm our new dynamic expression will manifest as a beacon of love, light, and wisdom for everyone. Thank you. We have many transformational experiences here at Unity. We are more than just a Sunday morning service, and there's a lot going on, so see if you can keep up with me. We offer many activities throughout the week to expand our awareness of God and bring us closer to each other. Join us today, right after the service, as we fill, bless, and pray for our new Unity pantry in the parking lot. The Women's Ministry will be gathering on April 7th at 6 o'clock in the Unity House living room to watch Wild, the movie based on the book from the March Book Club. The Women's Ministry also wanted to remind you the second Saturday of every month at 9:30, so that means next Saturday, will be the Women's Ministry Potluck Breakfast. It is here at Unity. Feel free to join and have a little chance to chat with the Women's Ministry. On Easter Sunday, can you imagine our sanctuary filled with beautiful flowers brought by folks to honor a loved one? Bring in flowers of your choice. Baskets and vases will be available. Knit, Crochet, and Give will meet April 15th in the Founders Wing classroom. If you're a crafty person and would like to know how to do that or would like to learn, please join them. Clean Up Columbia, April 23rd at 10 a.m., the rain date will be April 30th. Unity of Columbia has volunteered to clean up the trash on the Bear Creek Trail from Garth to Providence. Families are welcome. Bring your own gloves and a blue recycling bag or two. Please sign up in the foyer. If you have any questions, you can talk to Steph Brooks. Tomorrow is the deadline for the application to serve on our ministry search team. Applications are in the foyer. If you feel called to do that, please pick up an application after the service. A follow-up feedback survey on our vision, mission, core values drafts from the March 26th community session will be available soon. Your input is very appreciated. And after you go out and bless the pantry, come back in because we have beautiful art by Joel Chrisman, and he's with us today. So his art will be in the solar gallery. Thank you. It'll be in the solar gallery the month of April, and I went by, and there's some beautiful local iconic sketches that he's got, and just a little word on Joel. He also did some panels at Silent Unity back a while back, and there's an article about that too. So please come and welcome Joel after you bless the pantry. Today's word is inner peace. I think peace. I feel peace. I am peace. Peace lives in my heart, at the place within me where all appearances of separation dissolve. I feel only peace, only God, only oneness. This peace is always mine, part of my divine inheritance. I carry it with me through every experience, every moment of the day. Nothing can destroy or even disturb my peace when I invite the divine presence, the Christ of my being, to be my constant guide. A passing thought of fear, worry, or anger is a reminder to breathe, to release negative energy, to embrace peace. I feel renewed when I meditate, enjoy a walk in the peaceful garden, or take a moment to appreciate natural beauty wherever I find it. My indwelling peace manifests all around me, beauty, harmony, and bliss. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. From Psalms 29:11. Our affirmation is, I think peace. I feel peace. I am peace. Let's join together in speaking our affirmation aloud. Together, I think peace. I feel peace. I am peace. And now, repeat it to yourself silently.
I am free, I am unlimited, there are no chains that bind me. I am free, I am unlimited, right now, I am free, I am unlimited, there are no chains that bind me. I am free, I am unlimited, right now, I am free, I am unlimited, there are no chains that bind me. I am free, I am unlimited, right now, I am free, I am unlimited, there are no chains that bind me. I am free, I am unlimited, right now.
And as we take these powerful words and the music that takes us right to our heart, reminding us that we are free, that we are unlimited. There are no chains that bind us at any time. And during this time, we also, as we're centered in that musical invitation to look and choose again, we also say these words for our loved ones and for everyone on the planet. You are free. You are unlimited. There are no chains that bind you. And some powerful words to call us, continuing to call us, and to help us to remember that there's always a place within us where we're able to make a difference. To make a difference, even though we seem to be in some off-centered moments or some pain or drama or horror, whatever may be happening with us, to us, through us, by our thoughts, and also to other people through them around the planet and in our lives. And so a powerful time of coming into this experience with one another right now, whether we're here in a sanctuary or with each other online on YouTube, is the realization and the acceptance of the sacred. This is the sacred moment. Many sacred moments this morning. A sacred moment of the music and the singing bowl that always opens our hearts and minds, should we be paying attention. And the sacredness of our youth, of our children, as they gather to hear a heartfelt message from someone who loves and cares, and for all of us who are holding them in our hearts and minds. The sacred moment beyond the words. And perhaps there's been many moments this morning already, even at your awakening, or perhaps not in your awareness, where you've had a deep dive, a deep experience of, oh yes, this is what it's all about. So we take a few deep breaths right now, releasing, letting go. At a level of deep spiritual truth, there's really nothing for us to do. And as we become aware of our own identity of a sacred being, a sacred child, a sacred sister, a sacred brother, sacred son of the Most High, we realize that all is well. And so in a few moments, we decide to move into the silence. And the silence that is helping us to open, to pay attention to the sacredness, the message, the feeling, the thought, the peace in the silence, in the silence. As we gently return our awareness to the space of sacredness, with a realization, perhaps an increased willingness to be aware of the majesty of this moment of life, of life's that is springing forth everywhere in our heart and mind always, and as we look upon our human condition in our world, we also know and believe and we see and we affirm that we are free, that there is a place within us where there is peace, that we are unlimited. There's a place within us where the Spirit of God knows, on this journey of no distance to the goal that's never changed, and that's the peace, where we also feel and we see and we extend and we affirm and we know and we give thanks for that we are the bringers of peace. And so for this time, for this awareness, we say thank you. Thank you, sweet spirit. And so it is. Amen. Carol, thank you, Audra. You know, I'm blanking on the name of that, the source of that. Oh, yes. Yes, yes. Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Oh, isn't that just touch us at such a deep level? It is talk about new meaning, new sacredness. That's exactly what it's about. So this morning, a theme is, since it is Lenten time, we're talking about feasting and courage. Are we going to fast from fear during this time? Is a possibility. Are we going to feast on courage during this time, which is also a possibility? And so one thing, perhaps no one ran out of the sanctuary, or perhaps online they did, I would know, screaming when I mentioned the word Lenten. Because what's up in it for a lot of people, a lot of reasons that some folks come to the Unity movement is that we have quite a different way of interpreting and experiencing the original teachings, what we believe, of Jesus the Christ and of traditional Christianity, and it has, as Christianity has unfolded over the centuries. And you might say, well, that's pretty arrogant. How could we possibly do that? Well, it goes back to Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, a couple out of Kansas City, and very simply, you may not have heard this if you are new, that Myrtle Fillmore was diagnosed with tuberculosis at a young age and was told she wouldn't live beyond 30. And for some reason, she started paying attention and gathering. And she didn't take that. She wouldn't take those words from doctors and so on. She began to do what these days we would call very deep prayer, looking at the Bible, rereading the scripture through metaphysical lens, not necessarily literal, and guidance from inside. And she would even do what we would call, she would put Jesus in an empty chair and talk to Jesus and listen. Her life changed. She healed herself dramatically. That got her husband's attention. Charles was a businessman and wasn't necessarily into that at all at first. Long story short, their prayers began to be very powerful. People noticed around that community, and they started a prayer ministry, and that grew into what is a Unity movement these days. And we are not the only ones. Unity is not the only place on the planet where there are other interpretations and reinterpretations of, you name it, all kinds of beliefs. Now we notice there's still wars being fought on the planet on who's right. Related to that? And so anyway, what Lenten's all about and what we do with Unity these days, the Lenten practice is very traditional. And in essence, how many of you remember and have ever practiced feasting and fasting, or fasting and feasting? How many have done that through churches and so on? So a lot of us had that experience. I remember very clearly when I was 11 years old, our family moved to Northwest Michigan, a small town, and is a primarily Polish Catholic. They were very, very big on Easter and everything. And I grew up Presbyterian and Congregational and Methodist and whatever. And there's also a practice of Lent. And so would Unity also have some kinds of ways or wisdom what Lent is about and how it might be a practice for you? Sometimes within Unity and some churches of Unity churches, we moved away from these traditional practices because they seemed to be just a symbol that was not full of meaning. And somehow, those of us that were at one level, perhaps even resisting or are not wanting to do church or traditional anymore, we had difficulty with that. And so there's all kinds of reasons why perhaps we don't even talk about Lenten, the Lenten season anymore. But one thing that's really important is the word Lent, Charles Fillmore, co-founder, says, comes from the Anglo-Saxon word for spring, which is derived from verb meaning to lengthen. So Lent comes in the spring when the days become noticeably longer. And then this annual season of fasting, prayer, and presence has been observed by the Western Church since the first century after the birth of Jesus. Although it has not always been for 40 days long. In more ways than one, in recent times, has been kept beyond 40 days or sometimes even less. The first day of Lent is called Ash Wednesday, and then afterwards, what prevailed in the early church was sprinkling ashes on the face of people. And so Lent is a season of spiritual growth. And so the time of Easter, in some ways, is perfect for rebirth, is it not? Because we have the rebirth all around us. I mean, what we're sharing with our kids today and what we all know and the aliveness and the energy that comes forth when spring comes forth. And what I love is how quickly green just is coming up all everywhere. Spring is popping up all everywhere. And it's just awesome, isn't it? It's sort of like it's rebirth. And so the Lenten season is really talking about let's do some time of inquiry. What does it take for you and I to move into a new space and cleanse ourselves as we are going and hopefully growing through this time? What has been some cleansing practices and moments that you've had, say, in the last week? And it may or may not be a traditional Lenten practice in terms of spirituality or Christianity. But what about the concept of cleansing? We all know about cleansing diets. We all know about cleansing relationships, about healing, about taking time to, hey, this is really getting me totally off center. It's time for me to go home. And where's home? Inquire within. Home is where the heart is. Home is where your awareness of love is, your love, and love that exists everywhere. Could it be that there's a place in you and in everyone that is just calling for another look, calling for another possibility? So how do we do that? What are we going to do, and how do we feast from fear? Well, one of the things that is really up, I think, is we've heard a lot in Unity, and I say it a lot, and sometimes I wonder if I say it too much, but it really is a bottom line for everything. And I realize I understood this from Marianne Williamson and A Course in Miracles. Love is letting go of fear. The awareness of love's presence is blocked when we are aware of, even when we're unaware, that we're responding in fear or doubt or worry or anything that is not aware of the presence of this sacredness, the presence of love, the presence of possibility, where our heart sings. So we all, in some ways, we spend a lot of time wondering, well, what is all this about? And sometimes we don't want to say that we're ever coming from fear, because quite often fear is a heavily loaded word. For those of us on a spiritual or religious path, or whatever it is, and sometimes it's men, for men to be accused of having a fear response, we don't like that many times. Some of us don't. Who, me, fear? No, I'm strong. And so what is it all about? And so this time we can fast from maybe a traditional interpretation of fear, and just pay attention to go a little bit deeper. Sometimes we don't want to acknowledge that it's fear that's blocking our movement where we seem to be stuck. That's blocking our movement from healing. That's blocking our movement into new possibilities. And this, by the way, is not only for individuals. What in our world is blocking us from moving into new possibilities? We have examples of that all over the place. If I'm into fear, my ego is wide open. We have a super highway to a distraction. And when we're into fear, it's a hell of a distraction that we allow ourselves to be held hostage to the past, the present, and the future, our interpretation of the past, the present, and the future. So when I'm distracted from my truth, my spiritual truth, that I know, that you know, that everybody knows at some level, it's easy to let the feelings of fear slip in. And so let's pause there a moment. We talked about the word feelings. A lot of us really would understand if, think of a moment in your life, you had a strong, strong fear feeling. And there's great examples of that in our life. We all have that. And then what about an example in your life when there was something going on that you hadn't realized, that you just had sort of had a habitual response to pushing it or something or whatever away? All of a sudden you were having a wonderful day, you were happy and so on and so on. I remember these days when I lived in LA, and LA is sort of rather daunting to say the least with traffic and so on. A lot of places are. I was doing really great. I was going to teach a class on stress management. I would prayed up, meditated up, and all of a sudden on the freeway, somebody did their usual thing right in front of me. Imagine that. And I gave them the universal. I mean, that was one response. I wasn't coming from love, right? But then on another day, exactly the same kind of situation, feeling really good, something happens, and I'm fine with it. Well, go ahead, sister. Go ahead, brother. Cut in front of me. And so what's this about? So are we able to realize that it is our choice to make a difference, our choice to return to from the distraction and from the movement away to re-centering back to where we know is our truth. But we let a feeling, if we're not careful, will let us be in a time where we let the ego be the celebrated guest of honor in our awareness, in our heart. Not in our heart, in awareness of what we think is in our heart. So fear only holds open the door for more fear to enter. Okay, so it's important that we also recognize that fear is a natural instinct in the human condition, also one of protection, also one of getting our attention that something isn't right. And so we know that, and sometimes we can respond instantly, and it's life-saving and life-changing. And sometimes it's habitual in all kinds of different levels of fear. So it's like a paralyzing force that stands between me and my next right step forward. Fear tries to take the upper hand. My humanity reminds me of the existence of fear as a feeling. And when I focus on the fear itself, sometimes that's all I can see. So A Course in Miracles invites us to consider shifting our perception. So when we're aware of, call it a fear thought, if we're having trouble with language and what it is, or you feel so mixed up, you don't know what the hell's going on, how about just saying, I'll pause a moment. And what is it that gets you back off center, off from being tense? What's the practice? What's the possibility? Is it a willingness to say, I'm going to go there? And you've told people before, I've tried that many, many times, and it has never worked, and so just stop bringing it up again. No one here has ever done that. I talk to myself like that dramatically every day in some ways. And so it's like, will we make a decision to shift our perception? And, you know, it takes just a tiny bit of willingness. Once you are willing, if I'm willing to take that step into the unknown, that step into the fear that I don't want to transform, if I'm willing to do that, and then, well, do we have to say, I'm going to pause a moment now and think about it and go through the process and say, I want to make sure that I'm doing it right. That's one thing that will keep us stuck. And I want to make sure that so-and-so and so-and-so doesn't interfere, and that will be giving your power away, fear thoughts. And so until we analyze, we get paralyzed by analysis. And it goes on in split seconds. I mean, before you know it, your day is spoiled. Or your moment, or your lifetime. And I mean, I know it's the presence of truth of my being gives me a moment to choose again. In this presence of spiritual truth that I know, it's not what someone else tells you. I can sit here and babble on forever and ever. Nothing that I say is necessarily the truth for you or for anyone else but moi. But what about your spiritual truth? In the presence of your spiritual truth and the spirituality of your beingness, your divinity, you can count the feelings, ideas, and emotions and the feelings of fear, and you realize that they are no longer visibly present. They no longer have a emotional strangle on you. You've no longer given them that power. So that's what we talk about in feasting, in fasting. So what about the other part of it is feasting on courage. Now, this C word, the courage word, has many different interpretations, does it not? And what might be courageous for me or seeing that in others might not be what they see as courage. For example, we have all had the experience, especially during COVID time and during times of war, and other times we're getting used to being very grateful and thankful for people for the service. And we say, thank you for your service. And that became, as I began working with veterans and first responders and so on, with PTSD, it's so important to be genuine, not just as a tagline to say that you can comfort your ego saying you better say this to be cool. Do you really believe it? And so as we say that, one of the common responses when someone says to you, thank you for your service, and quite often one of the most common responses is, well, I didn't really do anything. And some may say, well, yeah, no, I really see you as courageous, and I thank you for that. And then we still, we don't want to accept that. So one of the things we talk about in working with and healing of veterans and everyone else, like, okay, what are we willing to accept within ourselves that we are on a hero's journey? That we have moments that anyone on the planet would say, yes, that's courageous. That takes faith. That takes willingness. How do you define courageous? Quite often it's being in sync with your spiritual nature and the nature that is calling forth for you on the planet. And so it's just beautiful that when we see that and when we all get to a point of recognizing that, oh, yes, that everybody here is on a hero's journey. I don't know what their journey, I don't know what your journey is. And so could that also be, if you're saying that for other people, couldn't it also be true for you? One of the things that I've been very aware of over the years, I've read all kinds of theories about psychology and spirituality and so on, and the theories of projection, for example, that what I see in out there is a projection of what's in me, or I wish it were, or it was, or maybe someday it will be. Could it be when we see someone else as a hero or heroine, whatever our words are, could it be, and we brought the tears by what they do? Could that be that is also within us? And could it be that it's really seeking expression? How? Well, through us. Do we really need to know, K-N-O-W? How about just taking a breath and say, oh, yeah. So I have some homework for you today, if you want to take it. And that is to do some mirror, M-I-R-R-O-R, therapy with yourself. Multiple times we're in front of a mirror, as we choose to be. You got to be careful with this maybe while you're driving. While you're driving, you may not be. You know, you can do it while you're sitting. But a couple of things, just two very basic things. First one is thinking of yourself. Wherever you are in any given moment in time, how are you doing with self-acceptance? How are you doing with unconditional positive regard? How are you doing with unconditional love for yourself in spite of whatever you did, but you know well? And then open for about 5 minutes, stand in front of a mirror when you're alone with nobody else around, and just say silently, as you look yourself in the eye, as only you can do, I love you, and use your name. I love you. Keep breathing and keep doing it. And if you're like me, the first time I did it, I stopped it. I said, well, this is BS. Of course I love myself. Right? And there's always emphasis that will come to you when you least expect it, right? And so just keep on with that. That's a practice. And finally, I kept going, and it took me a few moments. I finally started crying the third or fourth time I tried all that because, well, finally got to a place that, of course, I do. And then what about, then as you look in a mirror and you also maybe imagine or symbolize that somebody with you in that mirror and somebody or some situation that has your attention, and it's a call for love. It's a call for a willingness of courage, of willingness to see possibility. And to put that situation as you're looking at yourself at the same time, and you're also saying, I see the hero coming forth on that journey, in their journey, because I see it also in me. And so as we fast from fear, another way of interpreting fasting from fear is that we don't beat ourselves up for having a moment of fear or others. We just realize that, oh, well, how am I doing with that as a way of keeping myself separate and numb and all that? Or how am I doing with putting it in perspective and giving thanks that I have it, and what has it brought to me, and what am I willing to do? And then secondly, in terms of feasting on courage for yourself and for others, what does a feast look like for you? And there's so much out there that is a feast, a visual feast, a feast of love, a feast of community, and so on. And Unity of Columbia has a place to feast out, and you may have noticed. And we invite all of you to pay attention to that. So this Easter time, it is a time of rebirth, and it always is, no matter what time of year it is, rebirth. And so you're not alone. We're here together, we walk with you, and we say thank you. Thank you for joining us, and we will continue this journey of feasting and fasting and feasting and fasting and loving. What a concept. Amen.
As always, we return from our meditation and message filled with gratitude and peace, and today, love. And in that consciousness, we turn now to the spiritual practice of generosity. With this practice, we choose to dedicate a consistent portion of our time, talent, and treasure to our spiritual work and the work of our spiritual community. Now is the time to share our treasure. For those of you watching online, you can use the donate button on our website to make your gift. Remind ourselves that any gift given from the heart has the power to transform lives. This week, our gifts support the mission of Unity of Columbia and Unity Worldwide Ministries. So now, please hold your gift in your heart as we speak our offering blessing together. Divine love, one with me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I give, and all that I receive. I am joy-filled and grateful.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. Let it be. There will be an answer. Let it be. 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 Whisper words of wisdom. Let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. And I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. be, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be. And let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
We have two symbols of blessing today. First is the love offering given this morning. We bless these gifts and are grateful for this opportunity to make a difference in the lives of our spiritual family and the world. Second is the prayer box. In prayer, we expand our awareness that we are expressions of God, and we receive an abundance of all that we need to fulfill our soul's purpose.
We also take this time right now to hold people that are in our lives and awareness in prayer. We may have one word that we would speak aloud or in the silence, knowing that people of like mind and consciousness of the sacredness are holding you in whatever word you might say in prayer, and that your intention is heard and known and embraced. Take a moment now, if you wish, to speak aloud a prayer word or request.
Darren, Brian, Elliot. Carolyn.
Jim.
So we all take a breath and have of the expression of the words heard and unheard, answers seen and unseen, we say thank you. We understand, we affirm, and we go forth with gratitude. And so it is, and amen. Well, this morning we want to thank everybody for being here today. And as a heads up, right after the service, very quickly out in the parking lot, we have the blessing of the pantry that we're serving and giving to people, and invite everybody to join us out there for that blessing and dedication. And thanks to everybody that did that. And we also want to thank all the ushers and the staff and Audra and the Bill and Steve and Paul. I knew that. And everybody that's been a part of this service, it's been awesome. So let's stand and sing our prayer for protection and then peace.
God is here.
Our God protects us. The presence of God watches over us wherever we are. Yes, this is the moment. every step I take. Yes, this is my joyous path. Take each moment and live each moment in His eternity. Yes, there is peace on earth, and yes, it begins with me.